Our nation is so angry, so divided. What can bring us together? I remember 1968 when Martin Luther King was assassinated, Robert Kennedy was assassinated, the Democratic National Convention that summer went into meltdown. It was a terrible year, and we're exceeding, it seems to me, those levels of anger, bitterness, alienation, division, and so forth. We here at Emmanuel are where Jesus comes down with unifying power, because the Bible says in Acts chapter 10, God shows no partiality, no favoritism. We divide into warring camps. God brings us together in Christ, because when we see one another with gospel eyes, and that's what America needs, new eyes to see each other. When we see one another with gospel eyes, every single one of you is a divine original. If we could see up on the wall right now a Monet original, we would look at it with wonder. We would look at the very brushstrokes of Monet himself. You are a divine original, and so is the person sitting next to you right now, especially that person who is not like you. And when we perceive, we realize this, we see one another this way, we perceive one another this way, respect enters our hearts, even wonder. As we look at one another, guys, we have a rare historic opportunity for highly diverse people, in fact, natural enemies, to come together and love one another for Jesus' sake. Let's get after it.
Good morning, Emmanuel. We get to come together and worship the Lord today, and that is amazing. So stand and sing with us. This song is inspired by Psalm 145, which says, "The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. The Lord is good to all, and his mercy is over all that he has made."
The Lord is faithful.
So we run to the arms of our God. Welcome to church at Emmanuel Nashville. If you're tuning in online, we welcome you. We pray this service is a blessing to you wherever you are. So to all who are weary and need rest, to everyone who mourns and longs for comfort, to everyone who just feels worthless and wonders if they've just slipped through the cracks in God's universe, to everyone who fails and desires strength, and to everyone who sins and needs a Savior, this church opens wide her doors with a welcome from the Savior. Welcome, friends. Now let's get this worship service kicked off. Jesus opened up to us his deepest core being when he said, "I am gentle and lowly at heart." As we gather today, we are not being summoned to the principal's office. We are now invited into the heart of Jesus. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us worship God.
Say, Yes, our hearts can say.
Seated. And again, we're front-loading the sermon because we want to reserve time toward the end for prayer together, which we're going to do in a different way today with the help of some of our friends here. Now, I just noticed this week in my study, I have two copies of a book I wrote on Romans chapter 8 in French. I don't even read French. I can't use these. If French was your language growing up and it's the language of your heart, I would love for you to take one. Or if you know someone who speaks, thinks, feels French as, okay, David, there's one for you, and there's one other copy available, so you can come pick that up after church. Thanks. Okay, Romans chapter 8, and our verses today are verses 3 and 4. I'm going to start reading at verse 1, but our verses today are 3 and 4. Romans chapter 8. If you're using the Bible in the pew rack there in front of you, it's on page 944. Page 944. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. Now here are our verses. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin. He condemned sin in the flesh in order that The righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Now, verses 3 and 4 are a mouthful, aren't they? Let me read them again. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do. By sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin, he condemned sin in the flesh in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. This is God's word. So the gospel of God's grace for the undeserving can be the perfect excuse to go on and on in a morally unserious life. And maybe some of us are there. But you don't need to stay there. You just go down. You stop succeeding so much. Your success, your moral success, is fraudulent. And you go down to the level of chapter 7, verse 24. Wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? If that pain is your heart cry, you are ready. Right now, not by dusting yourself off and rehabilitating yourself. You're ready right now to receive the unqualified, unmixed, undiminished, industrial strength grace of God for you at your worst. Now, as I said, these two verses are a mouthful, so I paraphrase them to sort of accelerate the explaining process. So here's my paraphrase. God has done for us what his own law couldn't do. Not that God's law was the problem. The problem was our own deep down weakness, always failing to measure up to God's high and holy law. So what God did for us was this. He sent his own Son as an ordinary human being like us, but not weakened like us. When Jesus died on the cross, he became our sinful weakness personified, and God judged our failure there in our brother Jesus. So the old approach, with God's law demanding of us the impossible, that arrangement is now replaced by a new arrangement. Now, the Holy Spirit helps us obey God as we take one step at a time in his strength. These two verses, Romans 8, 3, and 4, explain and clarify the difference between Christianity and all forms of religion. Moralism, high-mindedness, all idealism, wishful thinking, self-exaltation. The difference is religion keeps flogging the dead horse of our potential. We're told oftentimes these days that deep down inside, every one of us is a basic wonderfulness that just needs a little, jump start, little inspiration to, prove itself. Does that work? Christianity says we're flawed right down to our deepest levels. And that, accepting that, works because God gives his Holy Spirit to moral failures like us so that we do start changing. As I said in the video earlier, our nation is so deeply divided That's obvious. What isn't obvious is all we have in common, way down deep. I mean, right and left, conservative and liberal, we're all united. What's really happening in America today is we are, oh my goodness, are we united? We're united in a brokenness. We're united in a stuckness that is so bound up with what we are that the Bible calls it the flesh. Not a choice. The flesh. People on all sides in America today want to pass laws to stigmatize and penalize the bad people. Okay. Good laws really matter. But Christianity says that God has done for us in our impasse what even God's law couldn't do. That's why we drove down to church today. Imagine if for just one day, everybody in Nashville, Tennessee obeyed the Ten Commandments. So let's just say tomorrow, February 11th, 2019. Imagine just one day in all the length of our city's history when we get up in the morning and we go through the day, all of us, everybody, loving God so sincerely, loving one another so fully that we spend our day setting the captives free, liberating the oppressed, proclaiming the day of the Lord's favor. For just one day, there's no theft, but only generosity. For just one day, there's no sexual folly, but only purity and safety, and so forth. For just one day. I mean, wouldn't we wake up Tuesday morning and think, man, can we do that again? But we've had the Ten Commandments all this time. What's right and humane and desirable and even obvious is weak because of the flesh, that is, natural-born us. Just natural-born us. So we need to quit blaming God and start thanking God because God has done what all forms of law, including our inspirational pep talks and our New Year's resolutions and our three principles for stress management and our five steps to a more balanced life and our seven steps to whatever, God has done what we could not do. That's what the Christian gospel is saying. So those words in verse 3, God has done, that's Christianity. Not what we should do, but what God has done. Not what God demands from us, but what God has done for us. That surprise is Christianity. And that's what everybody in America needs today. So Christianity, therefore, has a unique answer to an urgent question. And the question is, how, for crying out loud, do we change? How can broken people like us get traction for a better future? How can we stop being selfish and start becoming kind and just? How do we get better? And Christianity's answer is, we change not by law, but by grace. Not by coercion, but by gift. Not by ideals, but by mercies. Law doesn't change us down deep. Because, to quote Alexander Pope, the poet, the law is a sharp accuser, but a helpless friend. Grace does change us because grace cracks our hard hearts open to the power of the Holy Spirit from above. Christianity puts us in touch with both our real need and God's deep remedy. All right, now what we're going to do is just sort of think our way through these these two verses phrase by phrase. And I think here's where we need to go today. I'm going to guess that most of us here in church today maybe I should say it this way. I wonder if, have you ever once in your life said to God, I open my heart to your Holy Spirit? Why not today? First phrase, for God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do. Okay, now this is the first time in Romans chapter 8 we see the word the flesh. And it's in Romans 8 opposite to the Spirit, the flesh, the Spirit. And we saw last Sunday that the Spirit is the key concept in all of Romans chapter 8. So here's what you need to know. By flesh, he doesn't mean our bodies. Paul means just our natural born selves. He means just nice, everyday, smiling, well-meaning us, but that us held down by inertia, fatigue, complacency, defeatism, excuses, smugness, sarcasm, cowardice, compromise, selfishness, for starters. All of which comes naturally to us. Our problem is not that our every moment is equally bad. Our problem is our every moment is not miracle. What right do we have not to be miracles in God's universe? Who gave us permission? How crazy that beings created by God for the glory of God are not living as ongoing miraculous wonders. How crazy that we settle for what comes naturally and seems obvious. Who ever told us we could live like that? And what we do is we all settle for that and try to make the best of it. Jesus did not come into this world to say, make the best of it. If you're fed up with your life, you're in a good place. If you're basically okay with it, I don't know how that, from my own experience, how do we get out of that without suffering? So living at the level of the obvious, how's obvious working for us? Why not open up to divine miracle? There is a way to live every day in real time miracle that actually fits you. We'll talk more about that in a minute. Here's something else I want you to see. The word flesh, again, alerts us that what is wrong with us, and I've already alluded to this, it just goes, what's wrong with us, it goes deeper than a choice. In the film Lawrence of Arabia from way back in the 60s, that's a period of American history you might have heard of. It was just after the last ice age, and I remember it. Okay, Lawrence of Arabia, Peter O'Toole, I think it was 1965. Lawrence has been humbled by this time in the story. He has a conversation with his very close friend, Ali. Here's how it goes. Lawrence, I've come to the end of myself. Ali, a man can be whatever he wants. You said it. Lawrence, I'm sorry, I thought it was true. Ali, you proved it. Lawrence, he opens up his shirt here and grabs some of the flesh of his chest, and he says, look, Ali, look, that's me, and there's nothing I can do about it. Ali, a man can do whatever he wants. You said it. Lawrence, he can, but he can't want whatever he wants. This is the stuff that decides what he wants. We are often told today to make good choices on the basis of good information. Really? Is that easy? The Bible says we are so corrupted that for us, sin is as unchosen as hunger and as comfortable as sleep. How can we even want to obey God when if deep impulses within us decide to want other things? It's like trying to jump out of a hole that has no bottom. And we really are born this way. The flesh is the real you and I that we prettify with socially acceptable appearances. The flesh is our natural moral condition with both our virtues and our vices all mixed into it. The flesh can look good. The Pharisees proved that. But virtuous flesh is mean. Have you ever looked at a really obviously bad person and thought, well, I may not be perfect, but man, I've never sunk that low. That's the flesh talking. It's our horrible goodness. Our virtues impress us way too much. God sees through it all. Give me 3 square meals and 8 hours of sleep. I can be good, you know, for 5 minutes at a stretch, maybe. But my goodness is weak, boastful, and lazy. There's nothing supernatural about that kind of virtue. Christianity is not about virtue. It's about, it tells us there are two kinds. And natural, fleshly, school-taught, parent-taught virtue has, it does some good. I mean, What if we were as outwardly bad as we're actually capable of being? The world would be a living hell. We wouldn't last one more day. So outward compliance with just basic decency does good. But it isn't miraculous. It isn't of the Holy Spirit. And it just leaves us as we are. When the flesh encounters the law of God, which is what Paul wants us to think about, it's like a clip I saw on America's Funniest Home Videos. If anybody has I've looked for it, I can't find it. It must have been 20 years ago. And there's this cute little girl. She's standing up on the counter in her kitchen with a cupboard open, and she's been stealing cookies. Her mom walks into the kitchen with the camera going, you know, and says to her little girl, honey, have you been eating the cookies? And the child looks at her and snaps at her with defiance and shouts, what are you doing here? Go away. Then her mom calmly says, you have chocolate on your face. And that little child instantly softens, and her whole demeanor changes, and she says, I love you, Mommy. And both are the flesh. That's us. When the flesh collides with the law, God's law, first, there's defiance as the law peers into our lives where we don't want it to go, and we think, what right do you have to my private choices? And then, when our guilt is too obvious for even us to deny, the flesh changes to fawning hypocrisy and smiley Jesus talk, which really works well in the Bible Belt. Both defiance and flattery are forms of denial, and they come naturally. In both ways, the flesh weakens the impact of God's law by sidestepping the truth about us, and the flesh cannot change. We need a miracle. What's wrong with us, guys, is down inside us so deep we can't even access those levels of us. We're not even aware that they exist. We're way worse than we think. We literally need a miracle from God. And the wonderful thing is, the whole point of the gospel, he is not defeated by our weakness. The Belgic Confession of 1561 tells us, when God gave his son to us, he knew well that we were sinners. He knew what he was getting into. And he had everything ready, everything provided. What then has God done for us who are stuck with what we are and pretty much oblivious to it, not much bothered by it, as long as we can keep looking good? That's us. What has God done for that us? Next phrase. By sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin, we'll stop right there. So here the gospel takes us back to the most gracious and surprising moment in all of human history, the day when everything went horribly and wonderfully. God sent his son on a mission into our world. Our only real hope came from outside our world of image enhancement. And here we learn two things about the mission of Jesus. One, the Son of God became like us, the likeness of sinful flesh. He wasn't outwardly impressive. He was like us. He was one of us, but just not corrupt. We needed one to be not corrupt and a Savior. So if we want to see what a human being was always meant to be, we can look at Jesus. He came in the likeness of sinful flesh. Two, the other thing we learn here, Jesus came for sin, that is, to die as the sacrifice for our sin. So we, and this makes total sense to us because we all have a sense of atonement. When we're wronged, there is no way that can just be swept under the rug. We all know how false it is when somebody wrongs us and then acts as if everything is just fine. And we've all done that to God. And when he's not okay with it, we think he's being impossible. That mentality, that whole way of thinking is just, that's the flesh. It just comes naturally. But at the cross, here's what we didn't expect. This thought does not come naturally. At the cross, Jesus owned our wrong as if it were his wrong. He absorbed everything wrong with us into himself. And here's how decisive God was at that moment. Next phrase, he condemned sin in the flesh. Okay, now we finally see what God did that the law could not do. God condemned our sin. He brought it to an end. He condemned our sin in Christ's human flesh at the cross. In other words, God executed his final sentence on our sin in Christ's death. And what I want you to see is this. God's condemnation at the cross was so resolute and so final that he doomed sin's very presence in us. Something decisive happened at the cross. God did not create a possibility at the cross. God settled something at the cross. The evil we create, everything that dishonors God and degrades us, God decreed that our sin will not have the final say here in His world. God condemned our sin in the flesh of Christ, our friend, there at the cross. And we didn't contribute anything but the evil that made it necessary. And we heard Emmanuel, as we think about the cross of Jesus, we love this. We revere this because here at Emmanuel, we want to be forgiven, but we want more. We want to be rid of this wretched parasite the Bible calls sin. We want the whole world freed forever from this misery and this ugliness and this injustice. And the Bible is saying that at the cross, God took final responsibility for our offenses. God took the matter out of our hands. In one blinding moment of painful atonement, the dark energy of evil lost its grip and fell away, reeling under the blow. The law couldn't do that. God could and did in Jesus. So there are deep crevices down inside. I mean, I think of myself as this sort of globe inside with continents and oceans and so forth. And Jesus, the new king, comes and he lands on some beachhead somewhere inside this world called me and plants the flag of God's kingdom and claims everything for the glory of God. He's not going away. And then he just starts moving inland, creating civilization where I've just got jungles. But there are places in me he hasn't visited yet. And that's obvious to you. It's really obvious to Janny. Same with y'all. But he's not walking away. He's just gaining ground. The law couldn't do that. God sees it all inside you, inside me. And he isn't leaving because he dealt with it 2,000 years ago. And that is why you and I can be honest with God now as we discover things about ourselves that are even painful to realize. No evasion in us because no condemnation in God. Thanks to Jesus. Listen, if you have held out the empty hands of faith and just fallen into his arms with nothing to offer him but more trouble, he is holding you in his arms. And he is whispering to your heart, you are received. You are cleansed. You are mine forever. Rest. So, one more phrase. Here is how that really helps us and frees us and gives us positive traction as we, together here at Emmanuel, we just stumble forward. Last phrase. In order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. So God settles us in grace and peace to get us moving in grace and power. But Christianity, Martin Luther describing how we interact with the law of God, here's how he put it. It is just like a sick man who wants to drink some wine because he is of the foolish opinion that he will thus be cured. When the doctor, God above, not meaning to say anything at all against wine, tells him the wine cannot possibly cure you, it'll only make you sicker. He doesn't put any blame on the wine, but only on his foolish patient, for his patient needs some other kind of remedy in order to get well so that he can drink wine. So also our corrupted flesh is in need of another medicine than the law to become whole, so that it can fulfill the law. So, do you want to change? Well, the fact that you're here today means you do. And so do I. How do we change? Well, what we do is we forsake our own potential and we receive the Holy Spirit from above so that we can walk day by day, moment by moment, step by step, with power from on high. Walk according to the Spirit. If you will open your heart today and ask the Lord, would you send your Spirit into my heart, into my reality? You will not be just you anymore. You will be supernaturalized. God will replace the best that you can do, walk according to the flesh, with the best that he can do, walk according to the Spirit. Christianity is not moralism. It is miracle. Do not think, hey, I have the Holy Spirit, but I got problems. I mean, what good does grace do? Think, I got problems. Hey, but I've got the Holy Spirit too, so okay, hey, let's get going. The word walk, who walk according to the Spirit, the word walk tells us it's practical, moment by moment. The words according to tell us there's a guide to show us the way. The words the Spirit tell us we have help from beyond ourselves, and here's what that can look like at a very practical level. Let me just dive into one particular area of sensitivity, and I'll close with this. Many of us look at porn, both men and women. How does the Holy Spirit help serve and lift up a man or woman looking at porn? Let me change the question. How does a porn viewing person walk according to the Spirit? Three steps. Step one, honesty. The flesh will lie to you that it's no big deal. But we all know porn is a big deal. It abuses and degrades everyone involved. Step one in walking according to the Spirit is agreeing with the Holy Spirit against the flesh that it is so serious that it's high time to declare war on our own silken self-indulgence. So, honesty, facing ourselves, owning up. That's step one. Step two, hope. Step two is not beating yourself up, but believing the gospel. Facing the truth of it, the ugliness of it, and then believing the gospel. There is no condemnation in Christ for people who are looking at porn. And that hope is not that you might be accepted, that's the law, but hope because you are accepted, that's grace. So in your sorrow and shame and self-discovery and what was I thinking and how did I get here, you fall into the arms of Christ, your Savior, and find hope in him. All he wants to do is give you your life back. It's his only interest. So hope, looking beyond yourself. Step three, repent. Go back to the cross by faith. Go back to that moment 2,000 years ago. Stand there by faith at the foot of the cross where your lust was paid for and condemned. And while you stand there, look again and stare at it. Look at his naked flesh. Cut, torn, bleeding, abused. Look at the blood flowing out of his body. Look at the sweat. Look at the flies. Inhale the stench. Hear the mockery. Look into his eyes and realize that is what your porn did to him, and he does not hate you, but loves you all the more. And when you turn back to the cross in faith and in repentance, something will change inside you. Your lust will start dying, and your integrity will start living. The Holy Spirit loves to give that gift, whatever you're facing, as you hand yourself over to Jesus, who was crucified for you. So that's how you and I and every one of us, wherever we are in our journey, can start today walking according to the Spirit. This is, Romans 8 is not ideals that you might attain to. Romans 8 is God through Christ bringing the Holy Spirit down to where you are. Where you are. Where I am. I'm going to close this just briefly, but let me invite the band to come on up. And then we're going to sing a song in a minute. And after that, some of our friends are just going to lead us in a time of prayer. So again, the question is, have you ever said, Lord, send your Spirit into my heart? Have you ever said that to God? Why not right now? It isn't complicated. You don't have to deserve him. You only have to need him. And you open up and you say, okay, I'm done with me. I want you now. Who couldn't say that? So, we're going to pray together in just a minute. Thanks, guys.
Spirit.
We're going to go to prayer in just a moment, led by four of our friends. But before we go there, look, I know this is true of every single one of us. It's true of me. There are things in our past that are so hard to bear and even think about. And Jesus Christ, the Son of God, stands before us right now saying, no condemnation. The world might condemn you. You might condemn yourself. Societal opinion might condemn you. But Jesus says, no condemnation. You are received. You are cleansed. You are forgiven. It's over. Now, what we want to do, friends, is just be in God's presence as we gather, and prayer is the obvious place to go. And I realize some of us are still thinking, okay, I get it, I should pray, but I honestly don't know how. I honestly don't know. Beyond, you know, Lord, please bless my day. Well, there's nothing wrong with that. That's great. Good start. Here, though, is a commonly used, kind of standard, mainstream, non-weird template or pattern for prayer. Acts, A-C-T-S, adoration, just lifting the Lord up, honoring Him, putting Him first. Confession, owning up, talking about what's really going on, what we really need. Thanksgiving for all God gives to people who don't deserve it, and supplication, which is a wonderful fancy old word meaning a humble plea and asking God. So let's see. Phoebe is going to come lead us in a brief. Now what we're going to do is we're going to pray about 1 minute on each of these, so about 4 minutes. Guys, if we can sing a 4 minute song, we can pray a 4 minute prayer, right? So we're learning how to pray. Phoebe is going to lead us in a prayer of adoration. Ben, are you confession? Okay, come on, guys. And then Jake is thanksgiving, and Melinda is supplication. So they're going to lead us now. Thanks, guys.
Father of mercies and the God of all comfort, we are utterly exposed. Yet you do not expose us to condemn us, but you expose us to comfort us, because in that exposing, we look to Christ, who was exposed for us, who bore our sin and our shame. You alone are rich in mercy and great in love. What comfort for us sinners who are in need of both all of the time. Thank you for making prayer possible, not because of our eloquence or ability, but because you avail yourself to us and draw near in grace. Today, through the preaching of your word, we have seen that your generosity is uncontainable, that your plans are undefeatable, and that your grace is immeasurable. Your word says that you redeem the life of your servants, and that none of those who take refuge in you will be condemned. We praise you, our rock of refuge and mighty fortress. What safety and rest we have in you.
O Father in heaven, I am a sinner. I have done things and said things and thought about things that I am far too ashamed to admit. You are a gracious God, and your word tells us, Lord, that if we confess our sins, that you are just and merciful to forgive us our sins and cover them with the blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, we are a sinful people. We're a sinful church, and we ask, Lord, for your forgiveness. Forgive us for ever choosing anything above your Son, for ever choosing anything above your glory, O God, for ever looking to anything else for our joy but you. Forgive us, Lord. And we are a sinful city. It doesn't take a scientist to see. You walk out and you look around and things are broken, things are torn down, things are just seemingly unreconcilable, but God, you are in control. And we just ask that you forgive us, forgive me for all that we've sinned against you. Cover it, Lord, with the blood of your Son. Give us hearts that long for forgiveness. In Jesus' name.
Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the air in our lungs, for just the fact that we were able to get here to church. And we pray for those who weren't able to. We're so grateful for your law. It convicts us of all the things that you call us to do. And we thank you all the more for your grace. We're thankful for all the rich and abundant blessings that you give us. We live in a country that's wealthy. Many of us have far more wealth now than most people in this world can imagine. And so we thank you for that. And we pray that you keep us humble in that. And we thank you for the hard times. We thank you for the suffering. We thank you for the difficulties in this world. They bring our attention to you. They bring us to our knees and help us put things in proper perspective. For all this and more, we thank you. In Jesus' name.
We come asking, what a privilege you've given us to ask and knock and seek, Lord. And we do with all of our hearts, Lord. We ask for ourselves that we can fall in on our knees to mercies that you give new every day. Penetrate our hearts to hear these truths that we are not good enough on our own, that we fail. Even in our goodness, we fail. We wear faces and facades and try to be impressive, Lord, but you know our hearts. And so we ask, Lord, for more. We ask for more of your Holy Spirit. We ask for more than ourselves alone, that we would truly live lives of miracles that only can be pointed to your work in our lives. And we ask for more for Emmanuel. We ask for more of your Spirit to outpour upon us. We ask for that tender humbleness that we had in the beginning of, we don't know what to do, Lord, but we know you're with us. We ask that for our future as we grow and mature. Keep us from pride. Keep us from any kind of thing that would keep us from our focus on you. We ask for more of your Spirit to be poured out on Emmanuel. And for our city, Nashville, what exactly does that mean? Except lots of people are coming here seeking something and left with, I don't know if I belong here, loneliness. We're filled with people that have had dreams and not met, Lord. And you know what our needs are in this city. I ask for more believers, true believers in Christ who are spread out throughout each neighborhood, each community, each company. Lord, fill this city with believers and lights that light up you. And for the world, Lord, our heart breaks for what breaks yours. And so we ask, Lord, that you would bring many to Christ. Give us abilities to do that. Give us wisdom to do it. Give us language and speech to do it. But we ask, Lord, that you would awaken many hearts of our own, of our church, in our city and the world, Lord, to you, the true character of God. Waken us from our sleep. Amen.
We're going to continue now in worship, and what a privilege it is to be able to participate with God in the advance of His kingdom. He doesn't need our money. God doesn't need anything that we have, but He loves us too much not to let us participate. So at Emmanuel, it's our joyous privilege to pour our money out for Jesus, because what better can our money accomplish than when it's in the hands of God? There's several ways to do that up on the screen there. But as we go, we remember who gives us all of these things. All things come from you, O Lord, and of your own have we given you.
You can stand if you're not standing.
have Christ in you, the hope of glory, the very lifeblood of the Son of God, seated at God's right hand right now on the throne of heaven, flows through your veins. The righteous, the Bible says, are bold as a lion. We don't fear Satan. One little word will fail him. So here's how we can all leave church today. Maybe you're surprised at how bad you've sinned. Well, the blood of Jesus right now cleansing you from all sin means you can walk out the doors with your head held high, trusting in the risen Savior for you right now. You don't have to mope out of church today. You can be bold because Christ is in you. So we're going to have a guest reception. Pastor Ray and I will be there, Miss Janney. And we'd love to meet you if you're new or newish, or maybe you've been here a long time, but you just never met us. That'd be great. It'd be great to meet you today. If you would, just raise your hands and receive God's benediction as you go. Grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be and abide with you now and forevermore. Amen.